We are live at Chaska High School this morning, just hours from the kickoff to the prep football playoffs.
Oh boy, yeah, they're taking on New Prague. Randy says it should be quite the matchup. We're gonna check in with CeCe, who is live with all of these students who got up bright and early with us this morning in just a little bit. All always, smiles there, though.
Always impressed when the students get up to join us in the morning because they have a long day. I mean, they gotta have that energy ready for that game tonight, too.
They get to be on TV and be like, Mom, Dad, turn on TV.
That's
I'm
right.
gonna be on.
I mean, they're also like 17, 16, yeah, 18 years
energy.
Old. They got energy.
They got
That's
a lot
right.
of energy.
Guy.
Speaking of energy.
Let's check on that weather for that football
Woo!
Game tonight.
Yeah, it's gonna be nice and crisp later on tonight, too. So weather will be for sure cooperating for that game. So it should be a good one. You got some clouds right now, temps in the low 40s. Now, once you factor in the wind out there, it does feel a little bit cooler than that. So I would dress for the low 30s getting out of the door this morning. And temperatures warm to right around the low to mid 50s today. That's seasonal. I'm tracking a slight warm up this weekend. Plus, I'm diving into that Halloween forecast coming up here in a little bit. Alicia?
Guy, thanks. Looking at the roads for you. As you're getting ready to head out, we have one issue that I have been tracking along 52 westbound over in the East Metro in St. Paul. It's at 94. It's blocking this ramp. Crash there, blocking the left shoulder. Again, 52 westbound at 94. If this is your route, just give yourself a few extra minutes.
Well, this morning, more than 2 years after George Floyd's murder, we're getting a clear picture of the last remaining legal case and how it's going to wrap up.
Yeah, 24 hours ago, we were waiting for jury selection to begin. But this morning, it's a much different story. And our Jennifer Austin is live in downtown Minneapolis to explain everything we know at this point. Hey, Jen.
Yeah, so now the only court hearings still related to this case are possibly two sentencings. So here's what happened. As you saw, we were waiting for a jury selection to begin yesterday when we got this surprising news that former MPD officer J. Alexander King pleaded guilty to aiding and abetting manslaughter in the death of George Floyd. In return, prosecutors dropped the more serious charge of aiding and abetting murder. They're also dropping that charge for Tu Tao, but instead of pleading guilty to the manslaughter count, he is asking Judge Peter Cahill to review transcripts and evidence from the two previous trials and then render a verdict. So he is waiving his right to a jury trial. So no one will need to return to court to testify for this case again. University of St. Thomas law professor Mark Osler says this sets a national precedent moving forward.
In terms of having all of those involved be held accountable, that's pretty rare when we're talking about a murder by the police. And so this is an important threshold that's been crossed.
King's sentencing will be remote, and then Tao's sentencing remains if that is needed following whatever the judge decides there. Now, coming up in 30 minutes, we will hear from George Floyd's girlfriend about how she feels about there no longer being the possibility of any jury trial in this case.
All right, Jen, reporting live for us. Thanks.
The plea and decision to let the judge decide on a sentence brings closure to a criminal process hovering over Minneapolis for the last 2 years.
Yeah, no more testimony, and eyewitnesses do not have to relive the murder in court again. Now, Attorney General Keith Ellison released a statement saying he hopes that King's guilty plea, quote, can bring comfort to Floyd's family and bring our communities closer to a new era of accountability and justice. He also reiterated a hope for a swift resolution in Tao's stipulated bench trial.
The Minnesota Police and Peace Officers Association released a statement of their own saying, quote, communities from all over the state have supported their local law enforcement agencies. We want to take this time to thank you for your continued support, even when it wasn't popular to do so.
Well, the man accused of crashing into uptown protesters, killing one of them and injuring several others, is changing his plea in return for pleading guilty. The charge against 35-year-old Nicholas Krause has been changed to unintentional second-degree murder. Originally, Krause was charged with intentional second-degree murder for the crash last June that killed 31-year-old Deanna Marie.
Taking you live from St. Louis, Missouri this morning with new details on a deadly high school shooting that left a student and teacher dead and several others injured. It happened at a performing arts high school. Investigators say the shooter was a recent graduate of the school. He died at the scene. St. Louis police say officers were in the area when the shooting happened and were on scene in minutes. Police are still looking for a motive this morning.
This morning, we are 2 weeks out from Election Day in Minnesota. All eyes on the House, Senate, and governor's seats. But another election is grabbing attention as well. In just 14 days, we'll pick five new faces to sit on the Minneapolis School Board, creating a completely new majority.
Whoever gets voted in has a lot to tackle. First, choosing a new superintendent. School Board Chair Kim Ellison says they want to interview candidates by spring. They also need to balance a budget and negotiate another teacher contract next year. Minnesota could see a lot of new faces on school boards across the state. 1,600 candidates are running for 400 seats.
We've compiled a lot of important information for Election Day, like if you haven't registered yet, how you can do that in our Care 11 Voters Toolkit. Just text VOTE to 763-797-7215, and we'll send a link right to your cell phone. This morning, Minnesota is not making the grade. New data points the finger straight at COVID school closures during the pandemic. Right now, Minnesota's eighth grade average math score is the worst in 30 years. It's fallen since 2019. Fourth grade also saw a 9-point decline. Reading scores dropped in the state as well, but not as much as they did in math. Education Minnesota says it's time to wake up.
We have been sounding the alarm for a long, long time about the needs in our public schools. And I'm wondering if maybe this is finally the time for people to listen. Our schools and our students need help. I don't know that you can place it on one specific thing, but I guess a whole bunch of things that were exacerbated by the pandemic.
Despite the decline among Minnesota students, math scores were higher than the national public school average, with the eighth grade score ranking in the top 10. Well, back to